Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good to see you in the house of the Lord this morning. We want to welcome you to Liberty Point Baptist Church. If you're visiting with us, we're so glad that you're here. We would just simply ask if you would fill out the connection card, and we have an offering box near the front doors. We would greatly appreciate if you'd put that in so we can have a record of your visit. We have a lot of things to let you know about for way of announcements. If you have your bulletin, pull that out if you don't mind. Tonight at 5 o'clock, we have our leadership team meeting at 5, and then our regular business meeting at 6 o'clock. And so that will be here in the Family Life Center. And then Tuesday, we're going to the Equip Conference in Paducah, and there's a sign-up sheet on the bulletin board. We would love for you to be a part of that. We're going to leave the church parking lot at 4:30, and it's just a wonderful time. We'll have a dinner there. It'll be at First Baptist Church, Paducah. So if you're interested in any of the classes that are being offered, today is the last day to sign up. This Wednesday at 1 o'clock, we'll be at the Better Senior Living. And if you're able to come and be a part of that special service, we invite you to that. And then we have two new classes, Sunday school classes, that are starting up the first Sunday in September. We have a college and career class, then also an additional co-ed class that will be meeting here in the first room of the Family Life Center. And we want you to know that if you're not plugged into Sunday school, man, why don't you? We have classes for all ages, from nursery all the way to senior adult. And so with that, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this Lord's Day. We have gathered together this morning to worship you, to honor you, to express our love and devotion to you. God, I pray that everything that is said, everything that is done, would lift up the name of Jesus. God, we're thankful for the salvation that we have in him. We're thankful for the forgiveness of sin and the hope of eternal life that we find only in Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. Let's all stand, please. We're going to start off with a song called Our God Saves.
In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Spirit, Lord, we come. We're gathered together to lift up your name, to call on the Savior, to fall on your grace. In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Spirit, Lord, we come. We're gathered together to lift up your name, to call on the Savior, to fall on your grace. Hear the joyful sound of our offering as your saints bow down, as your people see. We will rise with you, lifted on your Spirit, Lord, we come. We're gathered together to lift up your name, to call on the Savior, to fall on your grace. Hear the joyful sound of our offering as your saints bow down, as your people sing. We will rise with you, lifted on your wings, and the world will our God saves, hear the joyful sound of our offering. As your saints bow down, as your people sing, we will rise with you, lifted on your wings, and the world will see that. And the world will see that. Our God saves. Our God saves. There is hope in your name. Morning turns to songs of
we have heard the joyful sound. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Spread the tidings all around. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Bear the news to every land. Bind the steeps and cross the waves. Onward is our Lord's command. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Give the winds a mighty voice. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Let the nations now rejoice. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. There's this nation going free. Highest hills and deepest caves. This our song of victory. Jesus saves, Jesus saves.
May be seated.
Good morning. 8 billion people in the world. 2.3 billion of those are Christians. 4.5 billion of those are other religions. And 1.2 billion people are non-believers or have no religious affiliation. Does that matter? 333 million people in the United States. Of those, 99 million people are not Christians. That's roughly 3 out of every 10 people do not know Jesus Christ. Does that matter? Let's get a little closer to home. 4.5 million people live in the state of Kentucky. 1.1 million people in the state of Kentucky are not believers. That's roughly 2 to 3 out of every 10 people will not go to heaven. Does that matter? 14,630 people currently live in Trigg County. Now, I don't know how many are non-believers right here, but I bet it's safe to say 2 to 3 out of every 10 people. Does that matter? I've told you all before a quote that I had heard that said, "You will never look into the eyes of someone that God does not love." That means it matters. Those numbers matter, and those people matter. Church, this week we want to pray for opportunities to reach those people and for conversations to start. We want to pray for mission moments to present themselves to us because it matters. But church, does it matter enough to get your hands dirty for kingdom causes? Henry Moyle said, "Prayer is a conversation with God, but it's no substitute for work." So if we're going to pray this week for these opportunities, we need to be ready to do the work. Does it matter to you, church? Ted, will you say a prayer for us?
Let's pray. Father God, we come to you this morning, Lord, with heavy hearts about what we just heard. Father, we ask that you instill in every one of us, Lord, the desire and the burning to spread your word. Father, give us all courage to mention to everyone that we meet, Lord, your name. Just the mighty name of Jesus can change lives. And Father, we just ask that you instill in us, Lord, this desire. And Father, just equipped each and every one of us, Lord, because we understand that we need to be prayed up before we do this, Lord. Father God, I just ask that you just put that desire in each and every heart this morning here, Lord, that you will be lifted up, that you will be glorified. And Father, all we can do is plant the seed. You water it and you harvest it, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for the promises you give us. Thank you for your love and your mercy. We love you and we trust you. In your holy and precious name, amen.
Stand once again, please.
Who brings the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless and all in wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. That I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory. Who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace, this unfailing love, that you would take my place,
sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. And you would take my place. Then you would bear my cross. You lay down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing. All that you've done for me. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appeared, the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy. The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. My chains are gone. Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed earth shall soon dissolve like snow, the sun forbear to shine, but God who called me here below will be forever mine, will be forever. You are.
when the music fades, all is slipped away, and I simply come, longing just to bring something that's of worth, that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. All about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it, but it's all about you. All about you, Jesus. King of endless worth, no one could express how much you deserve. Though I'm weak and poor, all I have is yours, every single breath. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it, when it's all about you, it's all about you.
Thank you. May be seated.
A few weeks ago, we looked at the story, or briefly, a portion of the story of a man by the name of Gideon. And as we looked at Gideon's story, we talked about how God has placed within us passions, and hopefully we're able to use those passions to glorify Him, and that God is calling us to do things far beyond what we even think we can do on our own. But when He works alongside us, or when He works through us, we're able to see things that we couldn't have even begin to fathom. Let me just remind you briefly of what was going on in Gideon's day. Gideon was part of God's people, the nation of Israel, and yet they found themselves being defeated over and over and over again. We also know that it was because of their disobedience. They had drifted away from following the Lord, and because of their disobedience, other countries, other nations, other peoples would come in and defeat them. Now, if you remember, Gideon's situation was a little bit different, because what would happen is every time they would acquire some things, these people would just come in and take everything they had because they were too weak to do anything about it. So Gideon is actually hiding food when we find him in Judges chapter 6, and that's where we're going to be here in just a moment. If you remember that story, Gideon is hiding his food so that no one can come and take it away from him. And I've just never been in that situation. Now, let me back up. There's been some times I've had some food that I didn't want anybody else to know about. And so I had my favorite candy, and I had a spot in a certain cabinet that I would hide it until that spot got found out. And so now every now and then I'll see somebody peeking in my cabinet, checking to see if there's anything good in there. I've hid food like that, but I've never hid food because I knew that somebody was going to take everything that I had and take it and leave me hungry. So Gideon finds himself in a unique situation. And we talked about how God wanted to use him in a special way. But this morning, I want to look at a little bit different aspect of Gideon's story. We find ourselves in this time as a church, kind of between sermon series. So let me catch you up on where we're going and then why we're where we're at today. Next week, we'll be partaking of the Lord's Supper together in our Sunday morning service. And so I'm certainly excited and look forward to participating and sharing that with one another. And then following that, beginning in September, we're going to be doing a sermon series that I'm extremely excited about. Our slogan here at Liberty Point is pointing people to Christ. And so beginning in September, we're going to talk about how we do that, what it looks like for us as a church to point people to Christ. And so we'll be doing a sermon series that I'm really excited about. And so this time between sermon series is oftentimes kind of challenging for me because I love sermon series and I love preaching through books. And so when there's a little gap, it's kind of hard for me to figure out, okay, God, what exactly do you want us to focus on? Where do we need to be? And so we've looked at several different things during this time, but I keep being brought back to the story of Gideon in my own quiet time when I'm just driving along, thinking about things. I keep coming back to Gideon's story because I think there's something so important that we didn't even begin to touch on the last time we looked at Gideon's story. And so this morning, I want us to look at the battle that Gideon had to fight first. You see, Gideon was able to go and defeat the Midianites. We looked at that the last time we looked at his story. But there was a battle that he had to fight before he got there. And so that's where we're going to be this morning. So if you've got your Bibles in Judges chapter 6, I invite you to stand with me if you're able as we honor the reading of God's word. Judges chapter 6, beginning in verse 12. Verse 12 says, "And the angel of the Lord appeared to him and said to him, 'The Lord is with you, O mighty man of valor.' And Gideon said to him, 'Please, my Lord, if the Lord is with us, why then has all this happened to us? And where are all his wonderful deeds that our fathers recounted to us, saying, Did not the Lord bring us up from Egypt? But now the Lord has forsaken us and given us into the hand of Midian.'" Let's pray together. God, we're so thankful for this time. God, the chance to be able to come together and to be in your house and, Lord, to worship you as we've had the privilege of doing so today. But, Father, now we have that distinct pleasure, God, of being able to hear directly from you. And, God, we pray that that's exactly what happens this morning. God, we pray that we would hear directly from you, that, God, you would speak to our hearts today and we would leave here changed because of it. Lord, move in this time for your glory and your glory alone. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. You can be seated. So you remember the angel comes to Gideon and he says, "The Lord is with you, O mighty man of valor." This strong warrior that's hiding his food, you remember. And Gideon goes off on this tangent. This is where his passion comes out, right? He's passionate about this. And he says, "Where is the Lord? If God is with us, where is he? Things don't look exactly like I thought they would. I've heard all these stories, all these wonderful deeds that God has supposedly done, but where is he now?" And he tells the angel of the Lord, he said, "The Lord has forsaken us." Man, Gideon is tore up about this, isn't he? He says, the Lord has forsaken us. You know, I can't help but think that many times we might feel like things are going a direction we didn't anticipate, that God has put us in a place where we didn't see it working out exactly the way things are moving and things are working out. And so Gideon is frustrated, like maybe many of us have been at times. But the question, the statement that he makes, "The Lord has forsaken us," is one that's simply not true. And the passage that I want to really focus in on this morning is going to tell us exactly who has forsaken who. Because after Gideon gets this challenge and gets this calling from God to be able to go and to be his servant, Gideon asked the angel to confirm that he's really the angel of the Lord, that he's really speaking on God's behalf. And then he gets his first task, beginning in verse 25. If you still got your Bibles open, jump down to verse 25. And we'll see this first task that Gideon is given. Verse 25 says, "That night the Lord said to him, 'Take your father's bull and the second bull, 7 years old, and pull down the altar of Baal that your father has, and cut down the Asherah pole that is beside it, and build an altar to the Lord your God on the top of the stronghold here, with stones laid in due order. Then take the second bull and offer it as a burnt offering with the wood of the Asherah that you shall cut down.' So Gideon took 10 men of his servants and did as the Lord had told him. But because he was too afraid of his family and the men of the town to do it by day, he did it by night." So did you catch what's actually going on here? Gideon, again, gets this angel of the Lord to visit him, and he's hiding food, and he's so passionate. And then his first task is, "Hey, Gideon, here's what I want you to do. I don't want you to go out against the Midianites. I don't want you to go out against the enemy. The first battle that you're going to have to fight, the first obstacle that you're going to have to face is not the enemy that you think that you're going to have to face. In fact, the first enemy is you. The first enemy is you and your own house. That's the first battle that you've got to fight. Before you can ever even begin to think about dealing with the Midianites, Gideon, you got to deal with yourself and in your own home." You see, it tells us that Gideon's father had an altar to Baal and had an Asherah pole that was beside it. You see, they were worshiping other gods in Gideon's own family. Gideon was so upset. Where's the Lord? The Lord has forsaken us. And his first task is, "Gideon, I don't think I'm the one that's forsaken you. And in fact, Gideon, if you'll understand what I'm dealing with first and foremost, you'll understand that you and your family have forsaken me. You've gone and you worshiped other gods. You've gone and focused on other things that aren't me. Gideon, I've not forsaken you. You're the one that's walked away from me." And so this first battle, before you go and fight the Midianites, you've got to deal with your own life and in your own house. Church, I don't know about you, but man, I can kind of relate with Gideon. Let me go fight somebody else, man. I know there's issues in my own life. I know there might be issues even in my own family, but let me go deal with somebody else, because that's a whole lot easier than having to deal with my own struggles, than having to deal with my own issues or my own family. I get it. Gideon is just like a lot of us, man. It's a whole lot easier to blame the enemy instead of putting the focus on ourselves and saying, "All right, God, what is it that you want to do in me and in my life?" You see, the first point that I want to make is that before we're able to do what God has called us to do, there's two things that's got to happen. There's two things that have to take place before we're able to defeat the Midianites, before we're able to accomplish God-sized dreams and God-sized visions and do the things that God wants us to do. There's two things that have to happen that I think we find in this passage of Scripture. The first one is preparation. There's got to be a certain amount of preparation that takes place. There's got to be some things that happen in our own lives, some preparation, before we're able to go and to do this. Now, you wouldn't expect any sports team to just be great, not have to do anything at practice. You wouldn't expect any army to go and win a victory without some kind of preparation. And the same is true for the church today, church. We've got to do a certain amount of preparation before we're able to accomplish all the things that God wants us to do. Several years ago, a Japanese emperor, several centuries ago, a Japanese emperor commissioned an artist to paint a bird. Not a huge task, but it was important to the emperor, so he got this particular artist, gave him the task of painting a bird. A number of months passed by. Those months turned into years. Several years passed by, and still no painting was brought to the palace. Finally, the emperor became so frustrated that he went to the artist's home to demand an explanation. Instead of making excuses, the artist placed a bank a blank canvas on the easel. In less than an hour, he completed a painting that was to become a brilliant masterpiece. When the emperor asked the reason for the delay, the artist began to show him armloads of drawings, drawings of nothing but feathers, drawings of nothing but wings, drawings of nothing but heads and feet and so on. Then he explained that all of this research, all of this time and preparation had been necessary before he could complete the painting. See, church, I think a lot of times we just expect things to happen, right? We just expect things to take place, and we expect it to happen instantly. And man, I've got a great idea. Let's make it happen. But I think a lot of times God is calling us to prepare. He's calling us to prepare not only ourselves, but to prepare the things that need to happen before we're able to accomplish what he wants us to do. Let me ask you this morning, church, is God calling you to prepare? Maybe this morning you feel like God has placed something upon your heart. God may be calling you to serve him in some particular form. Our church year is getting ready to begin, and we'll have some people in some new roles within our church. Maybe you feel the burden of that calling, the burden of that task that you've been given. Maybe this morning you say you feel like God has called you to ministry or to missions or whatever it may be. Hear me loud and clear, church. If God has called you to something, God has called you to prepare. He's called you to prepare for that task that he's given you. Things don't just happen. We have to prepare for them. To do those things that God has called us to do takes preparation. The second thing that I want us to see in this text is that many times the preparation is really our priorities. The preparation is really our priorities. You see, the deal with Gideon and his father's house was that they had no longer focused on the Lord. Their priorities were elsewhere. You see, they had this altar of Baal that his father had and the Asherah that stood beside it. Two altars to pagan gods. Not the God that brought them out of the land of Egypt. Not the God that they had heard all the stories of the miracles. Not that God, but to idols. To gods that couldn't do anything on their own. Man-made gods. Their priorities had shifted at some point along the way. They'd put the focus on things that didn't matter anymore. Church, if we're honest with one another, our priorities can do the same kind of shift before we ever even realize it. Not only in our individual lives, but even in the life of church, priorities can move so gently that we don't even realize that we're focused on things that don't matter. I read the story recently of a gentleman who was on vacation, or actually just traveling to teach with his sons. And he went and spent the summer in Mexico teaching. As his children went with him, they had a long drive. One of his sons decided that he was going to watch for license plates and try to get a license plate from every state. So as they traveled to Mexico, they got 24 states that they were able to check off of the list. And while they were there in Mexico, they saw four more. So when they started back to the United States, they were over halfway to collecting all 50 states. Returning back to the United States, they decided they were going to take a family vacation. And so the family vacation was to go to Yellowstone National Park. Supposedly, this is the license plate collector's paradise because people travel from all over the country to Yellowstone. By the morning of the second day there, his son had just one more state to go, Delaware. They had seen a license plate from all 50 states minus Delaware. And his son became so obsessed with finding the license plate for Delaware. When they stopped to see Yellowstone's magnificent sights, he didn't even take time to look at them. Instead of looking at the wonderful, beautiful things once in a lifetime for many people to see these things. Instead of looking at the sites there in Yellowstone, his son decided to run up and down the parking lot looking for a Delaware license plate. Talk about stress. You would have thought that his whole life depended on finding a Delaware license plate. They're coming towards the end of their trip, the end of their time at Yellowstone. They decide they're going to go eat at this cafe. Had a large parking lot at this cafe. And so the son said, hey, Dad, do I even have to eat? Can I just go look in the parking lot and see if I can find a Delaware? He says, no, son, you've got to come in and eat with us. Spend some time with us as a family. He said, but I really just want to go look for the license plate. He says, as soon as you're done eating, you can go out there. So he comes in, orders, and man, you would have thought it was a competitive eating competition. The kid just scarfs it down and then goes outside. A few moments later, he comes bebopping in to the cafe. He says, you got to come and look at it. You got to come and look at what? I found it. So the highlight of the trip was him standing beside the Delaware license plate, getting his picture made with it. They said in their family albums, the only picture of this son in any of the family pictures are of him standing by the Delaware license plate. Can you imagine being so focused on something that doesn't really matter? Being focused on something that doesn't amount to anything? That you neglect to see something incredible that's right in front of you. Church, that's exactly what Gideon and his family had done. And if we're not careful, that's exactly what we'll do. We will miss exactly what God has put in front of us. Exactly the most amazing of situations that God puts right in front of our face. The most amazing expressions of his love and his grace toward us. And church, we'll miss it because we're focused on something that doesn't matter. Something so silly as a license plate. Gideon and his family were focused on another God, so much so that they missed what God was trying to teach them. They'd made things that didn't matter at all, things that were worthless, things that were created by hands, and they'd put them in front and placed them on a pedestal above God Almighty. Gideon's first task. Gideon, if you want to defeat the Midianites, here's where we're going to start. I want you to go and tear those things down. Tear down the altar that's built to Baal. Tear down the Asherah pole. And we're going to build an altar to the one true God. And then you're going to take your father's bull and you're going to sacrifice it as an offering to the one true God. That's where it's going to begin, Gideon. What does Gideon do? He finds 10 guys, 10 friends, men that he trusts. And he says, all right, guys, here's what we're going to do. And Gideon gives them the instructions, and they do it at night. Verse 27 says, so Gideon took men of his servants and did as the Lord had told him. But because he was too afraid of his family and the men of the town to do it by day, he did it by night. Gideon is so scared of his own family, so scared of the people of the town, that he says, yeah, God, I want to be obedient to you, but I've got to do this at night because I'm scared to do it by day. What's going to happen to me if they see me out there tearing these things down? And before you start to give Gideon too hard a time, here's the most important thing. He did it. He did it. It didn't matter if he did it by day or by night. It didn't matter if he did it when other people were watching or not, the most important thing was that God called him to do it, and he did it. He was willing to deal with things that he knew were going to lead to problems. He was willing to deal with things that he knew were going to bring challenges to him, and he did it because he was obedient to the Lord. Church, let me ask you quickly this morning. Are you willing to be obedient even when it's uncomfortable? Are you willing to deal with things that might be going on in your own life? Are you willing to deal with things that might be taking place in the life of your family? Are you willing to deal with those things even though it might mean a little bit of discomfort? What if it means a lot of discomfort? What if it means it's going to be challenging? What if it means it's going to cause you more problems than you want right now? Are you willing to deal with it anyway because you know that God is calling you to do so? Gideon was willing to deal with the problems in his own life, in the life of his family. And I believe with everything that I am that only because Gideon was willing to deal with those things, God was able to use him for greater things later. Church, I don't think that we can have victory over the Midianites like Gideon did if we're not willing to do battle in our own hearts. So maybe this morning God's pointing out some things in your own life that you need to deal with. And I'm here to tell you that we'll never be the church that God has called us to be until each one of us is willing to deal with the things in our own hearts. So this morning, the invitation is simple. Whatever God is calling you to this morning, would you be obedient to Him? If that's repentance, turning away from your sin, I'm begging you, be obedient to the Lord. If that's surrendering your all to Him, I'm begging you, be obedient to Him. Whatever it is this morning, let's be obedient to the Lord. Would you pray with me? Father, we thank you so much for this time. Lord, we thank you for the example that we have of Gideon. God, a man who was able to do amazing things later because he was willing to deal with the sin of himself and his own family when you called him to. God, I pray this morning, Lord, if we've built idols out of things in our own hearts, Lord, if we've made things that don't really matter idols in our own lives, God, I pray that this morning those things would be torn down. God, that you would be our priority. God, that you would be the most important thing, and God, second place doesn't even come close. God, let that be true today. God, our priorities matter. But God, maybe this morning you're calling some folks to prepare. God, preparation is certainly important. So God, I pray that this morning, whatever it is that you've called us to, that we would begin to prepare for that task. And God, many times that preparation looks like our priorities. So God, we pray that you would use this time for your glory and your glory alone. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Would you stand with us?
I hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Lord, now indeed I find thy power, and thine alone can change the leper's spots and melt the heart of stone. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. And nothing good have I, whereby thy grace to claim. Wash my garments white in the blood of Calvary's Lamb. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed stretched it wide as snow.
You all know this next verse is my favorite, so we're going to sing it in just a second anyway. But I pray that as we sing it, that the words would just ring true to you. And when before the throne. See, this life is just temporary, church. We talked about that last week. And when before the throne, I stand in Him complete. See, what Jesus has done for each and every one of us is not just put us back together and take some spare parts. No, no, no. He's got a design for us, and He wants you to be complete. And the only way that we can be complete is to be found in Him. So as we sing this last verse this morning, I pray that we would sing it with all that we've got, knowing that what Jesus has waiting for us is something special, and that this life is just temporary. Let's sing again.
And when before the throne I stand in Him complete, Jesus died my soul to save, my lips shall still repeat, Jesus paid it all to Him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, He washed it white as snow.
Amen, amen. I thank you so much for being here today. I do invite you to come back and be with us tonight. 5 o'clock for our leadership team meeting and 6 o'clock for our business meeting. We certainly want you to be a part of that. We've got some important decisions in the upcoming church year, so we'll go through those tonight. And so please be a part of that. If you're a member, we'd love to see you here. Or if you just want to check out and see what a business meeting's like at Liberty Point, come and be with us tonight. We'd love to have you. Anyone else have anything on your heart before we dismiss this morning? All right, again, let me just quickly remind you one more thing. Our kids' church, our children's church program will begin the first week of September. Brother Charles Hyder is leading that. So, Brother Charles, would you care to dismiss us this morning?